Hello everyone, my name is Ishrat Wahab. I am an assistant professor in the Department of Tourism at Karan City College, Bangalore, and I will be teaching geography of tourism. So we all know that tourism cannot exist without the existence of geography. Being a multidisciplinary subject, the various subjects that it is related to, geography is probably one of the most important and major subjects or areas of studies which tourism is dependent upon. When we are talking about tourism, there are various components of tourism that we need to emphasize on. And out of these, there are five basic components of tourism, out of which the most important component of tourism is attraction. Now, when we are talking about attraction, it could mean, any resource which is naturally available, man-made resources, cultural resources, anything of that sort. So these are the pull forces, or these are the products which pulls tourists towards them, or which compels or attracts tourists to visit them. So when it comes to geography, I think any landform, any form of water body, the topography, anything of that sort always falls under geography. Today we will be emphasizing on a different aspect of geography. This is one of the most basic things that we need to learn. We need to teach students, and students need to learn as a part of the tourism curriculum. So today we will be talking about the importance of latitudes and longitudes, how they play a role, the basics of latitudes and longitudes first of all, and how they play a role in dividing the earth into various climatic zones and time zones. So as we start off, you would probably be able to see this circle, roughly a circle which is made on the board. So this is representing the shape of the earth. Now let me please tell you that the shape of the earth is not round. It is definitely not oval. It is not round, first of all. It has a particular shape where the top part of the circles are actually a little flat compared to the central or the middle part of the circle, which is a little bulged out, and this can be determined when we calculate the diameter. Now let us consider the directions: north, south, east and west. So when we measure the diameter of the earth from north to south, it is actually lesser than the diameter if you measure it from east to west, which is self-explainable, that the shape of the earth is flat, a little flat on the top, and it is a little bulged out on the sides. Now this particular shape is known as geoid or oblate spheroid. I'm just going to write it down for you. Right. So gone are the days when people used to say that the shape of the earth is flat like a disc. Then people say that it is round, but scientifically this is actually the correct term, geoid or oblate spheroid. So when it comes to the shape of the earth, there is also something very important, that there are many imaginary lines that run through the surface of the earth. We must have all come across lines like equator, the Tropic of Cancer, the Tropic of Capricorn. We know about latitudes, longitudes in general. But what are these imaginary lines that we are talking about? Let us emphasize on that today. First of all, let me just tell you that the axis of the earth, the x and y axis of the earth, is a little tilted. Earth as a circle or as a ball is not straight, it is little tilted, and the angle in which it is tilted is 23.5 degrees. Okay, roughly 23.5 degrees. So I'm just going to draw the axis over here. Let us consider this axis that runs from north to south, x and y axis of the earth, to be tilted at an angle of 23.5 degrees. And I'm sure all of us, when we notice at the globe in general, it is always a little tilted towards one side. And eventually, due to the rotation and revolution, from this angle, it comes to the other side. It starts getting tilted to the other side. So now we have the axis. So we have a lot of, as I've already mentioned, we have a lot of imaginary lines that run through the earth. Now there are these set of lines that run from east to west. Okay, and then there are the other sets of lines that run from north to south. So let us learn about what these lines are. So any line that runs from east to west are always parallel, because when you consider Earth as a ball, any line that runs from east to west is eventually going to circumnavigate and it will come as a circle. So these lines are basically running parallel to each other. The most important line that runs east to west, very well known to people, anyone and everyone would know about it, is the equator. Okay, this is known as the zero degree parallel of latitude. Okay, the 0 degree latitude. Now, what is the most important thing about this line is that it divides the earth into two equal halves. It divides the topmost portion into the northern hemisphere and the lower portion into the southern hemisphere. So there are many lines which are running parallel to the equator. I'm just going to draw some for you. Similarly, in the northern hemisphere as well, we have lines which are running parallel to the equator. Now, these lines are known as parallels of latitude. In simple words, if you want to define parallels of latitude, you can see that these are imaginary lines that are running on the surface of the earth. They run from east to west, west to east, and these are parallel to each other. Now, when it comes to the numbers, how many, there are specific numbers to all these lines that exist. There are 90 altogether, 90 parallels of latitude on the northern hemisphere and 90 parallels of latitude on the southern hemisphere. So that makes it 180 parallels of latitude which are running on the surface of the earth. Now there is another set of lines that we all know about that is known as the meridians of longitude. Now what are these lines? These are basically the imaginary lines that are running from the northern hemisphere to the southern hemisphere, the northernmost tip to the southernmost tip, and they are not parallel. They are actually touching each other on both the poles, and the most important thing is that they are more in number. There are 180 meridians of longitude on the eastern side of the earth and 180 meridians of longitude on the western side of the earth. Now, how do we define which is east and which is west? That could be a lot of confusion. So we have one meridian of longitude which runs through London, that is known as the 0 degree meridian or the prime meridian. Okay, so that is probably the most important, equivalent to the equator, the most important meridian of longitude. And directly opposite to the meridian of longitude is something called as the international dateline. So these lines, these meridians of longitudes, are very important when it comes to calculation of time of any place. Another thing that I wanted to mention over here is that the difference between each meridian of longitude is 4 minutes. Okay, we have a meridian and longitude over here. The next one would be at a gap of 4 minutes. Now 360 into 4 comes up to 24 hours. That is how these meridians of longitudes divide the earth into various time zones. Okay, so based on the calculation, based on the position of a place, based on the latitude and longitude where it is placed, we can actually calculate the local time of that place. And the importance of the prime meridian is that that is the only meridian which stands, which is always taken into consideration when it comes to the calculation of time of any place. For that matter, when we talk about India, India is towards the eastern side. It is at 82.5 degree east longitude. So when we calculate the time, eventually we get to know that India is 5.5 hours ahead of London approximately. Okay. So, we are done with the time calculation. How is it done? I've given you the basics already. When it comes to, I've already said that these imaginary lines can play a very vital role in dividing the earth into various climatic zones. So let's look at that. But for that, I'll just remove most of these lines. As we know that climate is also one of the deciding factors for tourism. Pleasant climate is something that people really look at. But yeah, there are other forms of tourism which are known as extreme tourism, where people want to go to places where there are extreme forms of climate. It could be extreme heat, extreme cold, extreme rainfall. But then when it comes to mass tourism, or you know, the herd population where they go, they basically look for places which have very pleasant temperature. So as we can see that I've drawn certain lines. Now these lines have their own specifications. The most important line, as I have already mentioned, is the 0 degree latitude, which is the equator. Next comes the next latitude, which I'll be marking out for you, is 23 and half degree north latitude. Similarly, we have 23 and half degree south latitude. We have 66 and half degree north. We'll mark 66 and half degrees south. And then we have the poles, the standard 90 degree. As I had already mentioned, there are 90 on the northern hemisphere, 90 on the southern hemisphere, that makes it 180 altogether. Okay, now when it comes to the climatic zones of the earth, a lot of it depends upon where upon the shape of the earth. As I had already said, that the shape of the earth is a little bulged out on the center and it is a little flat on the top. So for example, if I draw the sun over here, and if these are the rays of the sun, I've already said that the shape of the earth is a little bulge towards the center, which means that the closest to the sun is the central part of the earth. Which is the central part of the earth? The place through which the equator runs. Okay? So since this is the closest part of the earth, that is to the sun, this part is the hottest as well. Okay? This part, or this climatic region, is known as the equatorial region. Okay, now the specifications or the specialities about this region is that it is really hot throughout the year. It is hot. There is just one season that exists over here, that is summer. It is summer throughout the year. Secondly, as I've said, it's hot throughout the year. Yeah, and then there is a lot of rainfall. What happens is, because of the presence of a lot of water bodies and constant heat, this water starts getting evaporated and it comes down in the form of rainfall. So it eventually, this water cycle eventually leads to the growth of even more forests in this area. So the evergreen forests, the reason why these forests are known as evergreen is because it never sheds leaves. It's always green in color because of the constant rainfall and the constant heat. And this area is also very thinly populated because of the extreme temperature. People find it very difficult to survive in these areas. Okay, so the next, this actually basically runs from 0 degree to approximately 5 degrees north and south of the equator. First on the top of the equator, first 5 degrees, and below the equator, again, the first 5 degrees, okay? So this is probably the hottest, in general, the hottest place on Earth that exists over here. Now, as we can see that there's a curve over here, eventually what happens is that it moves away. These areas, they eventually move away from the harsh rays of the sun. But that doesn't mean that they become extremely cold, nothing like that. They become the tropical areas, that exist on the surface of the earth. 23.5 degree north latitude is known as the Tropic of Cancer, and 23.5 degree south latitude is known as the Tropic of Capricorn. Now, because of the almost round shape of the earth, we can see that the tropics are situated a little away from the place where the equator starts. So because of this, as it moves away from the harsh rays of the sun, this area is comparatively much less hotter than the areas in the equatorial areas. Okay, so the first important topic that we have in the northern hemisphere is 23.5 degree north latitude, which is known as the Tropic of Cancer. And when it comes to the southern hemisphere, the Tropic of Capricorn, it's 23.5 degree south latitude. Now, as we all must be knowing, the 23.5 degree north latitude passes through the country of India. It runs almost straight from Gujarat to Madhya Pradesh. It goes through West Bengal and a lot of other states as well. So the place, the speciality about this region is that this region receives rainfall. The monsoon rain always ensures that it visits these areas of the earth. Okay, and it is hot. The summers are prolonged and winters could be mild at certain places, and they are also harsh in other areas. Okay, so these places are actually very good for growing crops. When it comes to growing of crops, I believe rice, barley, tea, coffee, jute, a lot of these crops can be grown in these areas. Now, the next area that I'm talking about, let me mark it out for you first of all. If this is the equatorial area, probably the tropical area would be prevailing somewhere over here, right across the Tropic of Cancer as well as Capricorn. Okay? After we cross the Tropic of Cancer and Capricorn, we reach the Arctic and the Antarctic circles. It basically roughly lies around 66.5 degree north and south latitudes. So these are the areas which enjoy the temperate climate. When it comes to the temperate climate, it is neither hot nor cold. In fact, this is the area which gets to enjoy, literally gets to enjoy all four seasons: spring, summer, autumn, and winter. And when I say they get to enjoy all four seasons, you actually see these changes in the nature, you know, in the temperature, in the vegetables, the fruits, the trees, the vegetations, the behavior of the animals. It all changes according to this change in the season. Okay, so these areas are actually very good for growing fruits and vegetables. Okay, the countries that fall in this area, or the continents that fall in this area, are certain parts of USA, Europe in general, South America, South Africa, parts of Australia. So all these are the countries that actually get to enjoy all four seasons that exist. Okay, now as we move towards the top or towards the bottom part of the surface of the earth, we reach the tundra region. This region is very close to the poles and it has extreme, it's very cold actually. Parts of Russia falls in this area, and not much of vegetation is found. There will be many, basically the shrubs that or short trees that grow in this area. So Russia is basically one country which is, covering this area. It's known as the tundra region. I'm just going to mark it out for you once again. So the crosses basically stand for the temperate region. And tundra region is somewhere over here. Okay? These, as I've said, there is the population there in a lot of cities, the population is high compared to a lot of places which are almost deserted. Now, the last area that we need to talk about are the frigid zones. So these are the areas which lie on the polar areas, the Arctic Circle, the Arctic Circle and the Antarctic Circle. That's where it lies. There is almost no vegetation over there. Very few animals live. Probably we can talk about the polar bears or the penguins that exist, and there are certain tribes of people that live over there known as the Eskimos. So the speciality about these two areas is that it is 6 months day and again 6 months night. So as the axis is tilted at an angle of 23.5 degrees, it takes eventually 6 months for that area to receive the light, and there is day for the next 6 months. Okay, so as I have already discussed with you regarding the various climatic zones of the earth, why is it so important? The fact is that any tourist resource, no matter how good or bad it is, whether it is natural or man-made, whether it is cultural resources or anything of that sort, any tourism product or a tourism resources greatly depends upon the location and the climate of that area. No matter how good or beautiful a place is, if it has extreme climate, probably a lot of common people would not want to visit that place. That is why the climatic regions of the earth is so important for a student of tourism, because you as a tourism student, or you as a future tourism professional, need to know about how these climatic regions can have a positive or a negative impact at a tourist resource that already exists, or an upcoming tourist resource which is yet to be discovered. And when it comes to the meridians of longitude, it is very important for you to know that you need to learn how to calculate time. If you have a passenger who's traveling from Delhi to Abu Dhabi, from there he is traveling to maybe Switzerland, or maybe to Germany, Frankfurt in Germany, you need to know whether he is going to earn time or he's going to lose time. So the basics need to be very clear. Only then you'll be able to do the major calculations which will come on your way. Thank you so much.